Welcome to the weekly webcast. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living from our teacher and pastor, John S. Torell. Our hope is that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message and that you'll share it with a friend. King Pekahiah was an evil king that maintained the political hoax of the golden calves and served as a vassal king of Assyria. He was assassinated 2 years into his reign by Pekah, who favored an alliance with Syria. King Ahaz of Judah was aligned with Assyria, and as a result, Syria and Israel attacked the southern kingdom, killing 120,000 men. The Israelites returned to Samaria with 200,000 captive brethren, but a prophet of God rebuked the soldiers for their action. Assyria went on to conquer Syria and took large swaths of territory from the northern kingdom. An army captain named Hoshea assassinated Pekah to become the last king of Israel, but he had no real power since he was a vassal king of Assyria. Now, let's join Pastor John as he begins today's message.
Well, praise the Lord, and welcome to Resurrected Life of Jesus Church Worldwide. And I'm glad that you're here today as we're going to look upon the last days of the nation of Israel. Before we get to the message, I want to have a little talk with you and share something with you. We're living in the end times, there's no doubt about it, and things are going to get tighter and tighter. And God has been speaking to me for some time that He wants me to train people. And I call this end times spiritual warriors for Jesus. And let me just read this to you. We're looking for 10 dedicated born-again believers in Christ who are willing to enlist in the army of God as special forces. Qualifications: loving God with all your heart and wanting to do the work of Jesus. Age is of no difference. If you are in your 20s, you are up in your 70s or 80s, it doesn't matter. This operation is open for anyone that wants to serve the Lord. The training will make you a full Holy Spirit power disciples that will be able to lead people to Christ, learn how to cast out demons, break spells, pray for the sick, train people to become warriors for the Lord Jesus Christ. In this teaching I'm going to set up, we're going to look upon church history, we're looking upon world history, we're looking upon the world government, we're going to learn a lot of different things, and particularly end times. So it would almost be like if you would go to a Bible school or seminary. They really don't exist that have these courses. And it would simply teach you things that normally you'll not pick it up in a Bible college or some other place. So contact our ministry, get the personal appointment with me. Because what I'm going to do is this. I want people, now if you live outside the United States, sorry, you can't be part of this because you can't get into the country. The only ones that can get into this country are illegal people coming in from Mexico. But if you try to come in normally, then there's about 10, 15-year waiting period. I will try to videotape these things I'm going to do so that we can share them with you, but I cannot have you. So if you live in the United States, contact the ministry. You have a website, eaac.org, and write, call, or email us, and simply say, I would like to have an appointment with Pastor John. I will talk to you either on the phone, or I will talk with you over Skype, and discuss things with you. And if you feel that this is something you want to pursue, and I feel that you are qualified, then I would like for you to come to Sacramento and have a personal interview at our production center. And at that time, it will determine if you feel this is a program that you want to do in the end of your life or what you're doing now. And we will also be able to say that you qualify, because we've had so many people come over the years, and they last some a week, some people 3 months, and some people a year, and then they peel off. So I want to look for people, men and women, that are serious, ready to buckle down, not fly by nights. So that's what we're looking for. Now, as soon as I got this 10-person group signed up, we will start our training. So we will keep you informed. So thank you, and I pray that many of you will simply call us and say, let's check this out, and we will go from there. We're going to begin right now to talking about Israel and the last days of Israel. If you want to be ready, I'm going to be working in 2 Kings. So we're going to be working in 2 Kings, and then we're going to start in chapter 15 today. And so, 2 Kings chapter 15, and we're going to start in verse number 23. But let's pray right now. You're in the sanctuary, you're in the chapel. Will you stand as we pray? Heavenly Father, I want to thank you right now and praise you for your presence, for your Holy Spirit. And I pray, Lord, for an anointing upon myself, an anointing upon everyone watching and listening. And that, Lord, your will shall be done in our lives. Open understanding. Help us to learn. Help us to apply this in our lives. And this I ask in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen and amen. You may be seated. Well, let me read to you from my outline. The last king we talked about last week was Menahem. And the God had paused the virtual time run, and the last screenshot on the supercomputer showed the funeral for Menahem. The God had looked at each other in amazement that Menahem could have been so cruel and corrupt. He was a physical descendant of Abraham, but he was the spiritual son of Lucifer. They asked themselves this: could Israel be saved? It doesn't mean that God could not save them. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. But the people in Israel had a free will. Would they use their free will to be saved or destroyed? The last 4 kings had dragged the Israelites further into idolatry and immorality, even though the God had sent fiery and powerful prophets to warn the people. Israel would receive a little more time to rectify their behavior before there was a final judgment, and that was a decision they made. And with that, they resumed the time run. Now, Pekahiah was the son of Menahem. After his father bribed the Assyrians, Israel more or less became a vassal state of Assyria. And Pekahiah continued the evil worship of the golden calves. This was something that did not stop. The golden calf worship, it doesn't matter who the king was, it continued. It was engraved. As you look now after Thanksgiving, you will find that probably most of the churches that you watch on television or webcast, they now got their Christmas trees up. They got their different decorations up. And they're ready to celebrate Tammuz. And I'm just going to say a couple of things on this here. Israel never left God. They just added to God. There was not enough to have God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. They needed other gods. And this is what we're doing. Because, number one, Jesus was not born on December 25th. That is his body. Jesus does not have a birthday. Jesus is God. Jesus has always existed. Jesus had an incarnation date when he entered the body that Mary had furnished him in the Holy Spirit. And there's no place in the New Testament where we are told to celebrate the incarnation or the birth of Jesus. Not one place. The Christmas, which is on the 25th, was actually the time of Tammuz. This is a heathen god going back to Babylon. And Tammuz had been worshipped all these years, thousands of years. And when the Roman Catholic Church was founded about 325 after Christ, they had a discussion among the leadership. How do we get paganism out of the church? And they realized we can never get paganism out of the church. Let's take all the different religions that we have in the Roman Empire and let's Christianize the pagan holidays. Take the name of Tammuz out, put in Jesus, and spinning it. And so we are no better than Israel with the golden calves. They just continued. Now, the Assyrian Empire was being attacked by a number of vassal states that had broken away. Syria had been a member of the anti-Assyrian coalition, and the king of Syria at this time was Rezin, who reigned from Damascus. Some of the Israeli military leaders favored Syria, while others favored Assyria. There was a political undercurrent in Israel, and 2 years into Pekahiah's reign, a captain of the Israeli army named Pekah started an uprising. With the help of 50 men from Gilead, he used his credentials to enter the palace in Samaria and murder Pekahiah and assume the throne. Pekah received help from King Rezin, and once Pekah was established as the new king of Israel, the treaty was with Assyria was broken. Israel became a vassal state of Syria. Let's read now from 2 Kings 15, 23 up to 26. In the 50th year of Azariah, king of Judah, Pekahiah, the son of Menahem, began to reign over Israel and Samaria, and he reigned 2 years. And he did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord. He departed not from the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, who made Israel to sin. We need the church to be strong today. But in the church in America, we do idolatry, Christmas, Easter, Valentine's Day, Halloween, 4 different pagan holidays that the churches embrace. And then we wonder, why is not God moving? Well, God did not like the golden calves. God does not like pagan worship. So this is where we are, crippled. And he did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord. He departed not from the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, who made Israel to sin. But Pekah, son of Remaliah, a captain of his, conspired against him, smote him in Samaria in the palace of the king's house, with Argob and Arier, and with 50 men of Gilead, and he killed him and reigned in his room. He simply came in, murdered Pekahiah, and said, I am now the king. This was not of God. God was simply still speaking through his prophets. But the king, Pekah, he simply was going to do his thing. From verse number 27 and on, we read this. In the 250th year of Assyria, king of Judah, Pekah, the son of Remaliah, began to reign over Israel in Samaria and reigned 20 years. So he got 20 years in. And he did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord. He departed not for the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, who made Israel to sin. I want us now to turn to 16, 1 through 5. We always have politics. We have politics, idolatry, and they seem to push out our quest to be with God. In the 17th year of Pekah, the son of Remaliah, Ahaz, the son of Jotham, king of Judah, began to reign. 20 years old was Ahaz when he began to reign, and he reigned 16 years in Jerusalem, and did not that which was right in the sight of the Lord his God, like David his father. But he walked in the way of the kings of Israel. Yea, he made his son to pass through the fire, according to the abomination of the heathen, whom the Lord cast out from before the children of Israel. And he sacrificed and burnt incense in high places, and on the hills, and under every green tree. This king, Ahaz, he simply, what it means, passed the fire. Well, that's what you had the statues of Moloch and others. And they would fire them up. They were red hot. And they would take the children and lay them on their heated arms of iron and fry them to death while they were dancing and singing and worshiping their demon god. That's what this king Ahaz was doing. That's what he led people to do. I watched the news presentation yesterday. And this is a medical doctor from Los Angeles that was on One American News. I've seen this doctor before. He's down to earth. He works in the hospital. And he talked about the COVID-19. He talked about different remedies. And the question was asked him, is it true that cells from aborted babies are used in the so-called vaccines? And he simply stated this, yes, it is true. When they are working on a vaccine, trying to establish what to do, they have to have human cells, and they come from dead babies. A child when a child is conceived, life begins at conception. These babies are anywhere from 3 months old up to 6 or 7 or 8 months old. And I want you to see this. The womb of a mother should be the safest place in the world for a child. Here now are mothers in America and other nations too. They fornicate, or they simply don't want to have any more children. And they go to a abortion mill, and here the baby now is laying in there, and suddenly the baby is approached with thongs, suction needles and stuff. And it's that little baby screaming and trying to get away from it. There's no place to go. Mother doesn't protect the baby. And they die in agony. What do you think God thinks of that? Do you think that he simply says, well, bless the vaccine? When you take children, they sell these dead bodies. They freeze them, sell them to the pharmaceutical industry, and they use their bodies to make vaccine, so that people don't get sick, so they can live and sin. What do you think God is thinking? He's angry. He was angry with Ahaz. And this is why things are not going well for us here in the United States. Turn with me now to 2 Chronicles chapter 28. That's 2 Chronicles. I'm going to land in chapter 28. And we're going to read the first 5 verses. Ahaz was 20 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 16 years in Jerusalem. But he did not that which was right in the sight of the Lord, like David his father. For he walked in the ways of the king of Israel, and made also molten images for Balaam. Moreover, he burned incense in the valley of the son of Hinnom, burnt his children of fire after the abomination of heathen, whom the Lord had cast out before the children of Israel. He sacrificed also and burnt incense in high places, and on the hills, and on every green tree. Wherefore, the Lord his God delivered him into the hand of the king of Syria, and they smote him, and carried away a great multitude of them captives, and brought them to Damascus. And he also delivered into the hand of the king of Israel, who smote him with a great slaughter. God was displeased with Judah. God was displeased with Ahaz. Who had to pay for that? The people. I want you to understand this now. When we have a bad government in Washington, D.C., when we have bad state governments, judgment will fall. It would hit these people too. But it would also hit the people. The people would also have to suffer. Flip your page if you go to the next one. Now, Pekah had gone down to Judah. And in verse 6 he says, for Pekah the son of Remaliah slew in Judah 120,000 in one day, which were valiant men because they had forsaken the Lord God and their fathers. So we had here 120,000 soldiers were killed in one day. Did Ahaz think about that? No, he discontinued. verse number 7. And Zichri, a mighty man of Ephraim, slew Maaseiah, the king's son, and Azrikam, the governor of the house, and Elkanah, that were next to the king. And the children of Israel carried away captive their brethren, 200,000 women, sons and daughters, and took also away much spoil from them, and brought the spoil to Samaria. 200,000 women, boys and girls, were uprooted, forced marched from Judah up to Samaria. But the prophet of the Lord was there, whose name was Oded, and he went out before the host that came to Samaria. He said to them, "Behold, because the Lord God of your father was wroth with Judah, he has delivered them into your hands. You have slain them in a rage and reached up into heaven. And now you purpose to keep under the children of Judah and Jerusalem for bondmen and bondwomen unto you. But are there not with you, even with your sins, against the Lord God? Now hear therefore, and deliver the captives again, which you have taken captive to your brethren, for the fierce wrath of the Lord is upon you." The prophet said, "I did not commission this. You do this to these women and children, and the wrath of God will come upon you." In the next verses, you can read that they had a discussion among themselves, and they realized this was not a good thing to do, and they sent them back. Let's go back then to 2 Kings 15, 29. That's 2 Kings 15, 29. And we pick it up in verse 29. "In the days of Pekah, king of Israel, came Tiglath-Pileser, king of Assyria. And he took Ayon, Abel, Beth, Makah, Yanoa, Kadesh, Hazor, Gilead, and Galilee, all the land of Naphtali, and carried them captive to Assyria." This is the judgment. This was a huge part of Israel that was taken away. And I want you to say this now. God has emotions. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit have emotions. Remember in Genesis it said we are made in the image of God. God is love. But when God gets angry, his anger is a consuming fire. These areas that were taken now were cleansed. The Assyrian army came in, and they simply, after they killed some of the resistance, they took the men, the women, the children, and they started marching them off in columns into Assyria. I want you to see this with your eyes. These were probably hundreds of thousands of people. And the children would say, "Dad, why are they doing this to us?" They were crying. They would say, "Mom, I don't want to go." And the soldier around them said, "Anyone that does not keep walking will be killed on the spot." If you want to see something like this, there are movies of the Bataan March during World War II in the Philippines. When the Japanese took captive the American army that was in the Philippines, and they force marched them for hundreds of miles. And these men had no water, very little food. And the Japanese soldiers on each side simply said, anyone that falls down, we're going to put a bayonet in him and just kill. They didn't shoot them. They just stuck them with a bayonet, which is a large, like a knife. And these men struggled, and they saw person after person, friends fall by the side. This is the sight that took place. Why did God allow that? God simply said, I am so angry. You have for years, generation to generation, defied me. Now, I have no mercy on you. I'm done. You're going into captivity. You're going to be assimilated. And you're going to be no more a nation. Now, next we have Pekah killed. And we read now in verses 30 to 31 in that chapter. No, not there. There's no verses there. I'm in section 15, 30 and 31. And Hoshea, the son of Elah, made a conspiracy against Pekah, the son of Remaliah, smote him and slew him and reigned instead in the 20th year of Jotham, the son of Uzziah. So here now is Pekah. He was an evil king. He died and went to hell. 2 Kings chapter 17, and we read the first three verses. In the 12th year of Ahaz, king of Judah, became Hoshea, the son of Elah, to reign in Samaria over Israel 9 years. And he did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord, but not as the kings of Israel that were before him. You would think Hoshea was a murderer. You would think that the guy was simply saying, man, all these people of Israel was walked away to captivity. Maybe we need to talk to God. But he didn't do that. You see, people that are living in sin, they don't want to do anything. Now, in verses 1 through 4 here, we read this. Against him came up Shalmaneser, king of Assyria, and Hoshea became his servant and gave him presents. And the king of Assyria found conspiracy in Hoshea, for he had sent messages to the king of Egypt and brought no present to the king of Assyria. In other words, he didn't pay his taxes as he had done year by year. Therefore, the king of Assyria shut him up and bound him in prison. Then the king of Assyria came up throughout all the land, went up to Samaria and besieged it 3 years. In the 9th year, Hoshea, king of Assyria, took Samaria and carried Israel away into Assyria, placed them in Hala, in Habor, the river of Goshen, and the cities of the Medes. For so it was that the children of Israel had sinned against the Lord, their God, which had brought them up out of the land of Egypt from under the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and had feared or worshipped other gods. Israel now had come to an end. I want you to understand God had a great love. We had him called out Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, the 12 sons going to Egypt, Joseph, blessed by God. He raised up Moses. They had the great Exodus. He took them through the sea. He fed them in the desert for 40 years. Through Joshua, he brought them into the land of the promised land. And God said, I want to bless you. I want to prosper you. He had great plans. This was God's people. But God said, there's a time, it's a cutoff. And after this time, Israel ceased to exist. Let me take it to the last page of the outline. Shalmaneser was determined that Israel will never be a nation again. And once the 9 tribes were removed from the land, he brought in people from his empire, settling in the promised land. 17:24, we'll read this. And the king of Assyria brought men from Babylon, from Cutha, from Ava, from Hamath, from Sepharvaim, and placed them in the cities of Samaria instead of the children of Israel. And they possessed Samaria and dwelt in the cities thereof. If you want to see something that happened recently, not recently, but in our lifetime, the Soviet Union, the communists realized this, that in order to conquer the people they're taken captive, they had to resettle them. They took the Tatars of Crimea and brought them into Siberia. They took people from Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, from Poland, from other countries. They put them on trains, tens of thousands, put them up into Siberia, into the gulags in the northern part of the Soviet Union. And then they took Russians and put Russians into these other countries. And today, in the Baltic countries, they have a problem. They have about 20% of the people that are Russians. They are born there. But they were settled there to destroy the nations. And the Estonians, the Latvians, the Lithuanians saying this, if you live here, we don't speak Russian anymore. It's going to be our language. It's going to be our land. It's a mess when you do things like this. But the 9 tribes of Israel, as an entity of people, never came back. Some came back and became Samaritans. But the majority of them disappeared. Turn with me to 2 Kings 17, and we're going to go to verse 18 and on. That's 2 Kings 17, 18. Therefore the Lord was very angry with Israel. He removed them out of his sight. There was none left but the tribe of Judah only. Also Judah kept not the commandment of the Lord their God, but walked in the statutes of Israel which they made. And the Lord rejected all the seed of Israel, afflicted them, delivered them into the hand of spoilers, until he cast them out of his sight. For he rent Israel from the house of David, and they made Jeroboam the son of Nebat king. And Jeroboam drave Israel from the Lord, and made them sin and a great sin. For the children of Israel walked in all the sins of Jeroboam, which he did. They departed not from them. And the Lord removed Israel out of his sight, as he said by all his servants the prophets. So was Israel carried away out of their own land to Assyria unto this day. What about America? Are we going to be more protected than Israel? The answer is no. We really don't have any prophetic word in the Bible about America. There's really no place in the Bible where it says what part we play in the end times. Is it possible that God will be so fed up with us? He blessed his nation. We had revivals, 1600, 1700, 1800, 1900s. Great things happen. He blessed us. We are prosperous. We became the greatest nation on the earth. But as a nation, did we simply say, let's thank God and let's walk with God? On the opposite, this nation, most of the people that are running the universities, the Democratic Party, some of the people on the Republican side, they're spitting God in the face, defiant, woke, doing their own thing. Is it possible, and I want you to think about this, who did God use to punish Israel? Assyria. Is it possible that God simply says, I'm going to punish America. I'm going to use the Chinese and the Russians to attack them, to take them out of the land, to resettle them? Is it possible? The answer is yes. Should we take this serious? I would say we definitely should take it serious. Let's turn to Deuteronomy chapter 28. Because I really want to hammer something home today. See, as Christians, and I'm talking not to believers in Christ that are watching us, you know, we got our problems. We got conflicts here and conflicts there. You know, we don't have enough money. We don't have this. We don't have that. And we're not thinking globally, nationally. Where are we with God? In Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse number 15. We read this. But it shall come to pass, if you will not hearken to the voice of the Lord your God, to observe to do all his commandments and his statutes which I command you this day, that all these curses shall come upon you and overtake you. Cursed shall you be in the city. Cursed shall you be in the field. Cursed shall be your basket and your store. Cursed shall be your fruit of your body, and the fruit of your land, the increase of your kine, and the flocks of your sheep. Cursed shall you be when you come in, and cursed shall you be when you go out. The next verse is even worse. The Lord shall send upon you cursings, vexation, rebuke, in all that you set your hand unto for to do, until you be destroyed, until you perish quickly, because of the wickedness of your doings. Wherefore, whereby you have forsaken me. God spoke this to Moses. They were still outside the promised land. And God said, look, in chapter 28, in the beginning, it says, I will bless you. You will be blessed or you'll be cursed. You cannot be in the middle. And if you don't obey me, I will destroy you. In the same chapter now, let's turn to chapter 60, verse number 61. If you want to read all of them, it's terrible curses here. And in verse number 61, God said this, and every sickness and every plague which is not written in the book of this law, them will the Lord bring upon you until you be destroyed. Listen, pal, God says this to Israel. You sin. Every sickness, every plague, which is not written in the book of law, them will the Lord bring upon you until you be destroyed. If you look upon America today, we are sick. We're filling our hospitals. Cancer, arthritis, diabetes, you name the diseases, we got them. And it doesn't, people does not open their thinking and say, where is this coming from? Verse 62, you should be left few in number, whereas you were as the stars of heaven for multitude, because you would not obey the voice of the Lord your God. Let me slowly read that now. And you shall be left few in number, whereas you were as in the stars of heaven's multitude, because you would not obey the voice of the Lord your God. And it shall come to pass that as the Lord rejoiced over you to do you good, to multiply you, so the Lord will rejoice over you to destroy you. Listen closely now. God said this. Instead of rejoicing over doing good, God said, I will hurt you, and I will have joy in hurting you. That's a very serious warning. Do you hear that from Joel Osteen? Do you hear that from the prosperity preachers? Do you hear that from, how many churches do we hear that? I would say few and far between. And it came to pass that the Lord rejoiced over you to do you good, to multiply you, so the Lord will rejoice over you to destroy you, to bring you to naught, and you shall be plucked from off the land when you go to possess it. And the Lord shall scatter you among all the people, from the one end to the earth, into the other. And there you shall serve other gods, which neither you, your fathers, have known, even wood and stone. Israel was scattered. Later, Judah and Benjamin were scattered. And today you got Jews, remnants of the 12 tribes in every nation on this earth. Even in China, you have Jews. They are everywhere. They got scattered. They don't have a home. They tried to have a home in Israel. Constant wars. They built it upon sand. Listen to verse number 65. And among these nations shall you find no ease, neither shall the sole of your foot have rest. But the Lord shall give you there a trembling heart and failing of eyes and sorrow of mind. Your life shall hang in doubt before you. You shall fear day and night, that shall have none assurance of your life. In the morning you shall say, would God it were even. And at even you shall say, would God it were morning. For the fear of your heart, wherever you shall fear, and for the sight of your eyes, which you shall see. I did not write this. This is what God spoke to Moses. Let's just think for a moment. History. What does history tell us? Israel was destroyed. But 200 years later, Judah was destroyed. And they were scattered. They were hurt. They still are scattered today. They tried to set up a new state of Israel, but they're constantly at war. There's no stability. They're doing it in the flesh. What about our nation? If you and I as Christians don't take this seriously, who will? Do you think that the people that are at the bars this morning or today are going to talk about we need to seek God? Do you think that people that are going and watching movies today or are in the ball stadiums and watching ball games and things, do you think that they have a discussion about God? No. Do you think there's a discussion today in American churches that we need to repent, that we really need to be serious? Now, right now, they talk about Christmas and all the things they're going to do for Christmas. It's insanity. Let me read the final part to the outline. The God had passed the virtual time run. The last scene showed the people of the northern kingdom spread out for miles as they were evicted from Israel. The God had heard the curses of the men, the screams of the women, and the anguished cries of the children. The God was heartbroken, having done all they could for the people of Israel, but the people were hell-bent on sabotaging God's efforts. The judgment promised by the prophet had finally come to pass. There was no more mercy for Israel. Its people are going to disappear to the trash can of history. And they asked the question, only Judah remain. Will the southern kingdom remain true to the Lord? And this is a question I want to ask you today. Are you going to remain true to the Lord? Are you going to give God everything you have? Or are you going to be a part-time Christian that's interested more in doing your own stuff and peddling on the side a little bit about the kingdom of God? We are in a serious place. The pandemic, if you noticed, is not going away from us. They get the vaccine, the virus simply changes, mutates, and people get sick again. They're locking down in Europe and other places. They don't know what to do. It's a plague. God used Assyrians, Babylonians, to punish his people. God has used the Chinese to give us his virus. It's affecting the whole world. We've been blessed here at Resurrection Life of Jesus Church. We never closed our services. Even when there was the great lockdown, we never obeyed that. God has protected us. We are living in his grace. We pray every week for protection. God will make a difference. The question is, are we serious enough that we want to speak to people outside our church and tell them, judgment is coming, you need to repent? Think about this. All the people we talked about today are gone 2,600 years ago. They're either in hell or those that got saved are in heaven. The fate is sealed. It cannot change. We now are alive on earth. I'm thankful I'm saved. But I want to take as many people, women, to heaven as possible. And that's the reason I keep fighting. I'm not retiring. I'm not giving up. I will continue to preach and pray and seek the Lord until He calls me home. If you watch me today and you're not saved, this is a golden opportunity for you to say, I want to give my life to Christ today. I want to be saved. All you have to do is to simply say, I'm a sinner. I need to be saved. I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. I believe He died on the cross. I believe He rose from the dead. I believe He paid my sin. Jesus, come on in and save me. And He will. I had the opportunity last week to talk to somebody in another state. And the person read the Bible, prayed, and all kind of things. And they asked this lady, are you born again? Do you know Jesus? She said, I know everything about Him. I know about the Bible, I know about Jesus, I know about God, I got all the things. I said, do you know Him? No. I said, do you know who President Trump is? She said, oh, yes. I said, do you know where he lives? Yes. You know a lot about him? Yes. Are you his friend? No. I never met him. He doesn't know me. I said, the same thing with Jesus. You can read the Bible. You can know everything about him. You can do everything. But if you're not married to Jesus, if you haven't said yes, Jesus, I take you as my personal Lord and Savior, you're not saved. And the lady said, you're right. So I said this, how about if we now introduce you to Jesus? Are you ready to get married now? She said, yes. We prayed. And afterwards, her voice had changed, and she realized she had known about Jesus, but she didn't know him. Is that you? If that's the case, when we finish here, Pastor Charles will come on your screen. He will say, my friend, he will take you through and pray with you like I prayed with this lady. And you can know for sure today that you'll be saved. To those of you that are walking with the Lord, and you're in many different places here in the United States and outside, I want to ask you this. We don't know how much time we got left. Have you a calling upon your life? Do you feel that God has called you to some type of ministry? If that's the case, why don't you call us today and simply say, I want to talk to Pastor John. And let's discuss what you can do, what you cannot do, and what God wants you to do. I want to get you more active to the kingdom of God. We need men and women that can simply lead people to Christ, cast out demons, do deliverances, and minister, talk on the phone with people. The field is ready, ripe for harvest. I pray that you will think today. Don't stay with your plans necessarily, but simply say, God, show me if I'm in your will or if I'm doing something that I wanted. And if God says, no, you're not in my will, then ask him to show you what he wants you to do. May God bless you. Here's Pastor Charles.
Father God, we thank you for the confidence that we as Christians can have, that as we declare the spiritual truths that you have given us in the Bible, that it is not necessarily our job to beat it into the heads of people. We can present truth, but it is up to the individual to decide as to whether or not they want to accept it or not. And Father, we thank you for your Holy Spirit being here on this earth, that as we do present this truth, we're not walking in our own power and trying to do this, but that we have your Holy Spirit convicting people of their sins. That conviction power is so important. Father God, help people to recognize the conviction of the Holy Spirit in their life, and that they would realize that maybe tomorrow is not going to be an option. Today is a day of salvation. Father God, help us not to just delay things to the point, say, I'll just take care of it at some point in the future, but that we would, at the promptings of your Holy Spirit, just yield. And as we yield more and more lives to you, Lord, we thank you for the fact that you have good in store for us. You desire the best for us. And so, Father God, help us simply to be, again, salt and light here on this earth. In Jesus' name, amen. Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you'll die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth. And your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are, you've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person, doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you three questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything, even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all three questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these three questions are but three of God's 10 commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5:7 through 8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends His love toward us, in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man.
He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with His shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that He sent His own Son to pay a debt He did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are three places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of two places, heaven or hell. God did not send His Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by Me." You see, God offers His love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward Him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, He will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, He will do for you. If you call out to Him, He will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past, and there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All He wants for you is to come to Him. He will help anybody who calls out to Him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, He will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to Him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that You would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now, and I put my faith in You. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that You paid for my sins on the cross through Your shed blood, and that You died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank You for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with You. Help me to be obedient and to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and He has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to Him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Torell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever.
You have been listening to the weekly webcast of Pastor John S. Torell. This message was the 47th part in the series, The Origin Story of Jesus, and was entitled, The Kings of Israel. Pekahiah was an evil king that maintained the political hoax of the golden calves and served as a vassal king of Assyria. He was assassinated 2 years into his reign by Pekah, who favored an alliance with Syria. King Ahaz of Judah was aligned with Assyria, and as a result, Syria and Israel attacked the southern kingdom, killing 120,000 men, and returned to Samaria with 200,000 captives. But a prophet of God rebuked the Israeli soldiers for their action. Assyria went on to conquer Syria and took large swaths of territory from Israel, reducing it to a rump state. An army captain named Hoshea assassinated Pekah to become the last king of Israel. He rebelled against Assyria and joined with Egypt. Samaria was captured and Israel was destroyed as a nation. The warnings from the prophets finally came true, and the pathway to God's redemption was terminated when the northern kingdom was carried away into captivity to be mixed with other people groups. This message is available on CD and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1836. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can read insightful articles, watch or listen to a sermon broadcast, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to European American Evangelistic Crusades, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.